Thank you. How excited are you today? Okay, so thank you, Stacy, and good afternoon. My guest today, Kathleen Chalfant, is one of the greatest actresses of the American theater. Go right ahead. For her electrifying performance of cancer patient Vivian Baring in Margaret Edson's Pulitzer Prize-winning play Wit, she won every theatrical award possible. Yes. The Drama Desk, Lucille Lortel, Out of Critics Circle, Drama League, Connecticut Critics Circle, and the Obie. For her work in Tony Kushner's masterpiece, Angels in America, she was Tony nominated. She won her second Obie for Alan Bennett's Talking Heads. Kathleen began her career in New York in 1973. She worked with the newly formed Playwrights Horizons and Manhattan Theater Club. Her off-Broadway work includes Miss Ovington and Dr. Dubois, Somewhere Fun, Red Dog Howls, Painting Churches, Family Week, Vita and Virginia, Dead Men's Cell Phone, Spalding Gray's Stories Left to Tell, Nine Armenians, for which she received a Drama Desk nomination, Far Away, 12 Dreams, and Henry V. She has worked around the country with such regional companies as the Guthrie, Yale Rep, Long Wharf, Yale Repertory Company, Arena Stage, Hartford Stage, Mark Taper Forum, ATL, and the Sundance Lab. On film, she has been seen in such films as Isn't It Delicious, Duplicity, The People Speak, Lackawanna Blues, Perfect Stranger, The Last New Yorker, and The Laramie Project. On television, she has had recurring roles on House of Cards, The Americans, Rescue Me, The Book of Daniel, The Guardian, and Law and Order. Along with Elementary, Mercy, Muhammad Ali's Greatest Fight, Georgia O'Keeffe, and Storm of the Century. Well, she is back on stage at Manhattan Theater Club in David Grimm's new play, Tales from Red Vienna, which just opened last night to rave reviews, co-starring with Nina Arianda and Michael Esper. Please welcome Miss Kathleen Chalfant.
For you.
Thank you. I meant to wear my grown-up shoes, but I forgot. So don't look.
So tell me about last night. You opened last night.
We did. We opened last night.
How exciting was it?
Well, it's fun. The opening is always, you know, everybody who works in the theater in New York knows that the opening is fun because the judging is over. It doesn't matter then, and you just have fun, and everybody's come for free. So the price is right, and they're usually appreciative. So. It was very, and it's all, you know, your loved ones and friends and family and the people who have helped you get there. So it's nice. And then the board, because it's the not-for-profit theater, which keeps us all alive, you know. So it's all the board members who have come to see what they've been beating the bushes for. So it's a festive evening. So.
Well, I adored this play. How did the play originally come about for you?
They asked me if I wanted to be in it.
That's a good way.
And I said, okay.
So when you read it, what were your thoughts?
I loved the play. There were a couple of things that I had to choose between right then. You know, sometimes you have a pause, and then after the pause is over, then there's six things you're supposed to decide, and you would like to do all of them. But anyway, there were these two plays, one at Manhattan Theater Club and one at the Lincoln Center, and they were both sidekick parts. And they were both plays that I liked very, very, very much. So I didn't know David Grimm's work very well before that. He's the writer of Tales from Red Vienna. And I thought that this part, the part in Tales from Red Vienna, was the best sidekick part. It was, in this room, many people will understand these references. It's the Thelma Ritter, Eve Arden part. You know.
Those are the best parts, right?
right.
So talk about the role.
I play a woman named Edith Schmidt, who is the housekeeper, and I am conservatively twice the age of anyone else in the play, which is a very interesting position to be in. So I play the housekeeper, and I think people imagine that she must have been Nina's nurse, so she's always just been with her, and it's in 1920, It's the sort of aftermath of the aftermath of the First World War, a very difficult time in Vienna. And in a way, the world is seen through Etta's point of view, because if you are downstairs, if you are the help, you see and move things as well as participate in them. And one of the, I haven't played downstairs for a while, and I'd forgotten that the downstairs people have all the props. Have all the props. And it's great. It's great fun. And she, this woman, has a deep relationship with, she's a deeply protective relationship to, for, with, prepositions, that's what they always get to, the prepositions, with Nina's character, Helena Altman, who is the central character in the play. So it's wonderful. It's wonderful to do, and it's wonderful. It's, you know, you're transported to Vienna in 1920 for all the good of it and all the bad of it. And I gather that it's quite beautiful to look at. As you know, you never know what it looks like when you're in it. But people say, whoa, that's great. So because it's John Lee Beatty has done the sets, and Anita Yavich, the costumes, and Peter Kazarovsky, the lights, and glorious sound design by Michael Bodine with lots and lots and lots of Mahler. So it's cool. But Richard knows. You saw it.
It's stunning. It's such a beautiful production because the sets change. I mean, it's so beautiful.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You're in the beautiful apartment first, then you go to the graveyard. I mean, it's so stunningly designed. Talk about working with this cast.
Oh, it's an amazing company. There's, but as and all half my age. So the people that people know are Nina Arianda, who was in Venus and Fur, Tina Benko, who just finished being Titania in Midsummer Night's Dream in Brooklyn. And Michael Esper, who has moved from American Dream to Mad Hungarian in Vienna in 1920. And then there are two wonderful young actors, a young actor named Michael Goldsmith, who's been, who went to school in Scotland and has only been back in New York a little while, who is stunning. And a wonderful actor named Lucas Hall. So it's a great company, and we had Kate Wariski, who's best known, I think, for directing Ruined, was our director putting this difficult, complex play together. It's been quite a thing. It's fun.
Talk about working with Kate, of putting this whole play together in the rehearsal room, and what you love about her as a director.
What do I love? I love. She evolves as the process evolves. So there's a kind of continuous directorial process all through the beginning. Because I've begun to understand after you're 110, you've finally done it a million times. You think, oh, it does. There is some pattern to the thing and some way to do it or something. So. In particularly in theaters in New York, if you're lucky, you get a 4-week rehearsal period and a week of tech, and then 2 or 3 weeks to practice in public. And each of them has a different rhythm and purpose. And the wonderful thing about Kate and the best theater directors, I think, is that they evolve as the process goes on, so that they're, and they, my, I think one of my favorite directors was Derek Anson Jones, who directed Wit. And what I always thought was so wonderful about Derek is that he gave you notes when you could take them. You know, had faith that we would move forward, and that thing that everybody else is standing around saying, well, why don't you tell him to, if I were doing it, this is how I would. Instead of doing that, it evolves with the process, and then finally, a note is given to you at a time when you can say, well, of course, absolutely. And Kate's that kind of director. And she also has a great rhythmic sense for orchestrating the movement on the stage and is immensely collaborative with her designers, particularly in this case with Michael Bodine, the sound designer, because the music, as it is in Vienna, the music in this play is very, very important and establishes the rhythm of the scene changes and set changes and stuff, which is important for me because I have all the props.
You do all the scene changing.
I do, I do.
Well, she does a lot of it. Moving the coffee cups, taking everything
off. Yeah,
it's great. I'm like, she's still out there. She's still performing.
Right, she's back.
Yeah, she's back. I want to go back to the beginning. Growing up, where did your love for performing begin? And what were your early creative outlets?
Well, that's a long time ago. Anyway, I grew up in California. I was born in around the Bay Area. I was born in 1945, so I'm the post-war child. January of 1945, it was almost over, the war. So I grew up in around the Bay Area, and then eventually we moved up to Sacramento, and I ended up in Oakland, California. For those of you people who have seen Fruitvale Station, I lived on Fruitvale Avenue in a great big boarding house my parents owned that had been a hotel. So it was kind of like growing up as a low-rent Eloise. We had 50 rooms, and there was a lot of performing went on in that. But when I was little, in Sacramento, my English grandmother took me to the movies. And she was supposed to take me to the kid movies, but, you know, she was easily bored. And so sometimes we went to the kid movies, but sometimes we went to see, like, Miss Sadie Thompson with Rita Hayworth. I found illuminating at the age of however old I was, 8. Ooh, that was good. So I was not an only child, but my only sibling was my much older, 14 years older, glamorous gay brother who encouraged me in all these activities. But I'd come home from the movies and act out all the plays in the backyard. Or, you know, and I really thought, actually, that I wanted to be in the cowboy movies for two reasons. One, that I could ride a horse. And two, that somebody would kiss me, because in the natural course of things, it was unlikely to happen. That didn't happen, but I didn't ever get to be in a cowboy. I've never ridden a horse in my professional life, which is a sadness. I have been kissed from time to time. And so I did, you know, I did the things that kids do. I acted out the movies, and I went to ballet class. My first public performance was in April Showers at the Sacramento State Fair under black light. Everybody remember black light? We had, you know, pink and blue costumes. It was great. you know, I went from being a shepherd to the Virgin Mary in the Christmas play, in that kind of way you do. And then when we moved to Oakland and the big boarding house, I learned almost everything I know from somebody in the boarding house. I learned to play chess. I learned to ride a horse. I flew for the first time in an airplane. I learned French, and there was someone who belonged to a community theater. And the community theater movement in California, I don't know in the rest of the country, was very, very strong and sort of semi-professional. It was before the not-for-profit theater came. And so I worked as what would now be called an intern, but actually was a slave, at the local theater when I was in high school. And my father would come in a great rage at midnight and haul me out of the theater and take me home. And I had my first sort of professional appearance there, taking over for somebody singing. I don't sing. I couldn't sing then, and I can't sing now. But I sang, and that's when I discovered that if you're really nervous and trying to sing, you can't hear the piano. So that was not entirely successful. But, and then I was in the play in high, in all the plays in high school, and did lots of things. And my last high school performance was I played Hedda Gabler at the age of 17. I had no idea why she would kill herself. But I could play the tarantella with a fair amount of skill, sort of, anyway. But anyway, so, and I expected that I would, I went to Stanford and I was going to study the theater at Stanford, but I didn't, because I fell in love, and as you know, the theater happens at night, and so does your boyfriend, so, because he wasn't in school, he'd been kicked out, and so, anyway. Somehow or another, I ended up studying Greek, and I was great. I studied Greek, and that was good. And it was in, I was at Stanford from 1962 to 1965. I graduated a little bit early, and so it was the 60s at Stanford, and people made movies, so I was in movies. But I, interestingly, didn't set foot in a theater all that time. And I didn't think about it, but I didn't. And made, you know, experimental movies the way you do in college. Mostly we had our clothes on. I think we almost all entirely had our clothes on. And then I was supposed to go to graduate school. And by that time, I'd met the person to whom I'm married. I've been married to Henry since 1966. Thank you. I hope he would clap. I think so. It's ours. Mostly it's turned out okay. But anyway, before we were married, we went off on this scandalous trip to Mexico on Christmas vacation, which scandalized my parents and everybody. And they, my mother said famously, well, I guess you were sleeping with John, too. So anyway, on the way back, I said to Henry, you know, I really don't want to teach Greek to prep school boys. And he said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I've always wanted to be an actress. It was 1965, so he said actress. Always, and he said, why don't you do that? And it had never occurred to me by at that, and I did, which was not like me, because I was the good, I did what I was supposed to do. I went to school, and but I did. I dropped out. I was supposed to start a graduate program early. I dropped out of the graduate program. I'd been given special dispensation to be the chief justice of the student court at Stanford. I went to the dean of women, told her I'd been to Mexico with my boyfriend. And I wouldn't be being the chief justice. I don't remember telling my parents. I must have. They got on right away. And I dropped out, I left graduate school and got a job as a secretary because the only useful skill I had was typing. I was pretty good. So I got a job as a secretary for an architect in San Francisco, and I started acting class. And I didn't do what I should have done, which was to apply to graduate school in the theater, because I didn't believe it was the real thing, you know? It didn't seem possible. And so the rest of my career sort of grew like Topsy in that way. I went from playing the nurse in The Curious Savage at the beginning of my acting school in San Francisco with this man named Larry Bedini, who was quite a wonderful teacher. And he was a disciple of Boleslavsky and had been at the Abbey Theater. And so I was lucky, and I've always been lucky in my teachers, to the girl in Night Must Fall by the end of the thing. So I made some progress. And by then, Henry and I were married, and we went to live in Europe and ended up in Rome. And I studied acting in Rome with a wonderful teacher named Alessandro Fersen, who looked like Stanislavski. And he had been the artistic director of the Piccolo Teatro di Genova, and was very, he was a Stanislavskian and very interested in what it was in people that made them want to transform. And I studied acting in Italian for 2 years, 2.5 years, which was miraculous, really, miraculous. And then we came back home, and then we went to Woodstock, New York, and by then we had one child, and our second child was born. Andromache, who is a wonderful set designer, by the way, now in the theater. Andromache was born in the third week of rehearsals of a production of Major Barbara, in which I was playing Major Barbara. The director had five children, and so he said, "When is this child due?" And I said, "Meh." Then he said, "Okay, I think it's going to be fine, but you have a choice. You can play Rummy Mitchums, or you can play Major Barbara, what do you want?"
And you chose the lead.
I did. I chose, you know, the way you do.
I love that. So what year did you move to New York City to start your career?
I moved to New York in 1973 from Woodstock. And we had a friend up in Woodstock named Bob Burgos, who was the only person I knew. He was a wonderful actor that some people may know was an actor in New York. And Bob was the only person I knew, and I said, "What do I do when I go to New York?" And he said, "The best teacher in New York is Wynn Handman, and you should go to the American Place Theater and see if, you know, there's any work you can do there." And so on my 28th birthday, which I thought was impossibly old, I went to interview with Wynn Handman on, I don't know if any of you studied with Wynn, the old studio was on 55th Street, and he took me on. I have no idea why, because in those he interviewed, and I studied with him for off and on for a couple of years, and then I was lucky. I was sitting under trees when apples dropped down, you know, and it sort of in my. It's sort of an amble more than a career, I think. Grew like Topsy, and I've had astonishing good luck, you know, to be sitting under the tree that Tony Kushner was sitting in, for instance. Yeah. Or to be sitting under the tree that held Derek Anson Jones, who happened to be carrying around the script of Wit. You know, I mean, lucky.
Yeah. Well, early in New York, you started out at like Manhattan Theater Club, and playwrights only had just started, right?
Right. The very first play I did in New York, like actually it wasn't. I think I was, you know, somebody in the back of The Ideal Husband at some tiny little theater. But and then I did two plays by a playwright named Stephen Shea, who is now a surgeon. And directed by Paul Cooper, who continued to be a director and to work in the theater. And Stephen wrote these kind of abstract plays, and the characters all had letters. And in the first play that I did of Stephen's, which was done at the Manhattan Theater Club when it was on the Upper East Side, in that, remember that building? My letter was H. And then in the next play I did, it was in Playwrights Horizons at the Clark Center, before it moved to 40, because I helped Bob move it to 42nd Street, and I was B. So I had made some progress in the play, and that play was called Jealousy, and I was B, I was the wife, Jane Haynes was the mistress, and my friend Bob Burgos was the husband, and it involved many things, including a big red head of cabbage and an axe.
A comedy.
Was a called Jealousy. It was great.
Yeah. But early on, you appeared with a young Harvey Fierstein in a play called Program?
Pro-game.
Pro-game.
Megan Terry, a play, again with Jane Haynes.
You played his son?
I did. I played his hockey-playing, gum-chewing son. and it's where I learned about upstaging, because I didn't know. I had this hockey, gum-chewing, hockey-playing monologue downstage, and we were rehearsing, rehearsing, and people were just dying with laughter. And I thought, oh, that's pretty funny. I thought, oh, that's better than I've ever done this. I don't know. I don't think it's this funny or anything. And I turned around, and Harvey was directly upstage of me in a house dress, curlers, with his legs splayed so that I was in the V of Harvey, not doing anything else. It was great. And we have been friends ever since. And that play was directed by Harvey Tavell. Yeah. It was, and it was at St. Clement, not at St. Clement's, at that fell down. On the Lower East Side, Theater Genesis.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah.
Your first success on stage was in Jules Feiffer's Hold On.
Hold Me, Hold Me. Yeah.
What was that play?
That was at the American Place. Had a kind of cabaret space then. K. Michael Patton, who is now the best acting teacher in the whole world for anybody who wants one, and the best audition class. If you can get the job in K's class, you can get the job. Anyway, K was at that time the youngest casting director in New York, and beginning her career as a director. And she'd done a number of pieces in this cabaret space. And she was working with Jules Feiffer on this piece called Hold Me, which was based on Jules's cartoons and many of the characters in the cartoons, the central one of whom was the dancer, who was played by the wonderful Dalian Majors. And we did it, Paul Dooley was in it, and we started at the American Place and moved to the West Side Arts, and then it went to Los Angeles and Philadelphia. I left after Philadelphia because I had children at home. And that was a wonderful thing to do, and that was my first that sort of big deal thing in New York.
You know, you started talking about auditioning. I know we have a lot of actors in the house today, and a question that comes up all the time is how daunting auditioning is. Were you good at auditioning? Do you like to audition?
No, my favorite story is in this very class, Wynne Hanman's class, sometimes when Wynne had to do something, he'd have Kay, who's now my oldest friend in New York, my dearest friend, come and take the class. And so she'd hold auditions. And the very first time I met her, I was the only person in the class who wasn't called back in the audit. So that was the basis of our friendship. She insists that she doesn't remember that, but I do, because you would remember that if that happened to you. So no, auditioning is very, very, I think, difficult for everybody. You know, the older you get, the more you've done it, and the less it feels like your life has ended every time you don't get the job. But it takes a while. It's like little children, you know. You don't have any library of experience when you're starting out, and so it's horrifying. And everyone says it's not personal. And having been on the other side, most of the time it isn't personal, but it feels personal because it's you. So I think that it's important. I mean, there are some people who are great because they take it as a challenge. You know, it's like a puzzle. It's like doing crossword puzzles for them. And they're those, I mean, beata loro, because that's a great thing. If you're not like that, it's very good to find a really rigorous audition class that gives you a number, because you need tools to manage the terror. And if you have tools to manage the terror, then you can use it as work and practice. And as time goes on, there's more and more practice, you know. And it gets easier. Or any particular one matters less. But there are techniques for managing it. And it's hard, and the, one of them is to understand that it's hard for the other people. Because they actually want you to be good. They don't want to spend all day watching people be awful at it. What they want are a lot of choices. And when that happens, then it's not personal. And a lot of times you get, I find myself often in the position of being the first or second choice, except a famous person. And that's a perfectly honorable position to be in. And that has nothing to do with you. And it means you've done your job, you've done the best you could possibly do. And then it's in the hands of fate and commerce and, you know, famous people. And they've worked hard to be famous, so good for them. You know, it's part of the life. And so after a while, you realize that there's no point in hating it. That after a while, the best thing to do is just prepare for, do what you can to control the variables. You know, especially for movies and television, because everybody has to audition for the movies and television. Learn it. You know, so that it's backwards, so you don't have to think about it. And that's all you can do. Just control what you can control. And the rest of it, you can't do anything about. So you can't make yourself taller or them more awake or the famous person not available. You can't do anything about that.
You know, it's interesting. Andrea Martin was in this chair, and I asked her what the best bit of advice she had been given. And she said Martin Short told her, don't take anything in this business personal.
Yeah.
That, you know, it's not you, like you said. They wanted someone 5 inches taller, or, you know, it has to do with every other variable but you. But we all walk out of those auditions thinking that, oh, what did I do wrong? But it's
and
not.
I'll tell you how, because I know how, this is a case where, yeah, I got it. It was between the famous person that was the first choice was Queen Latifah. She wasn't available, so they hired me. Go figure. You know, you can't make this stuff up. So in that world, you have no control. You just go and do your thing, and they'll figure out whatever it is they want to do, you know?
That's a great story. Perfect.
And Queen Latifah's splendid, as we all know. I'm glad she wasn't available.
You know, going back to your acting teacher, I read something you recently said, that the older I get, the less and less serious I am about my method. What did you mean by that?
I don't know how it works anymore.
Yeah.
I don't have a clue. And when I was, there are these, I was talking about those three stages of the thing. They still exist. You do your rehearsal work. You learn it, you go stand where you're supposed to stand, you listen to the other people. It's great, as you get older, you actually can listen to them. It's not some weird direction that people give you, so listen to them. Well, what do you do when you're listening? Actually listen to them. So that's always a good thing. And you play just your part. You don't pretend that they've done what you think they should have been doing. You have to deal with what it is, whatever, as they have to deal with you. So you do that during the rehearsal period, and then you go into tech and you play, and then you begin to practice in public, in the theater this is, and you realize that the other participant in the event has shown up, which is to say the audience, and you understand that it's an act of communication, and that's very mysterious. I think the only thing I know about it is that you want to communicate. The audience isn't the enemy. The audience is the purpose in the theater. And the thing that you make is this thing in the middle between what's here, between what we're doing up here, and what they're doing out there. And it's a different thing, this thing. And it's alive. That's why it's alive, and that's what's exciting about it. And that's mysterious. And there comes a moment when you can also do that other thing, the famous mysterious thing where they say, be in the moment. What could that possibly? I'm in this artificial thing. I'm up here saying somebody else's words. I can hear the lady chewing gum in the front row. What can you possibly mean? And after a while, you can do it. Doesn't mean you don't hear the lady with her candy wrappers or rummaging through her bag because God knows what she forgot. It is usually women who do that, which is distressing for us, but you can get to a point where you've transferred the thing you've learned over all this time into your muscle memory, and you can jump off. You just start, and you believe that the rest of the thing will unfold, and it does, and it's great. And entirely mysterious. And you know, and sometimes it unfolds in a better way than other time. You know, and every once in a while you trip over the furniture or whatever it is you do, and then brings you maybe out of the moment for a second, thinking, oh, I just tripped over the furniture. Or, oh, I was supposed to bring, this happened to me last night at the opening. Oh, on that exit I was supposed to bring the napkins in. I didn't, did I? Well, I guess I better get them now. But there's a, everybody know there's a kind of double consciousness. The job is different in the movies and television because you don't have the audience or the continuity, but you do have the luxury that of the fact that almost anybody can do anything for a minute and a half, which is about how long you have to do it. And you get to do it a couple times. And now with digital technology, I mean, it got to be there at the end of film that you didn't get to do it a couple times because it was too expensive and nobody could be bothered to do it again. So however it was, that's how it was. But now with digital technology, you do get to do it a lot, sometimes too many times. And the it's equally mysterious what the camera sees is quite mysterious, and you don't have any control over it. It works for some people, and it doesn't for others, and nobody can say why that is, I think. But I think the job in both cases is the same, which is to fill the available space so that you're doing the same thing, but you're doing it in this space, rather than in this giant space. But it's equally mysterious. I was in a movie, I played Tim Robbins' mother a number of times. And in one of the movies where I was playing Tim Robbins' mother, I was standing next to him and I couldn't hear him. And I thought, oh my goodness, what is this? And in the movie, when we saw the movie, he was splendid. And it was this incredibly, I don't know, I don't think he knew what he just knew what he was doing, how to do it. It's very mysterious, this thing that we do. And all you can do is control the stuff you can control. You know, learn your things and listen to the other people and know what it means, what you're saying means. Which seems like an obvious thing, but isn't often. People often worry about how they feel about what it means that, or what it is that they're saying. But if you know what you mean by what you're saying, then the feelings will come, because that's what we are. We are, as actors, entirely transparent creatures. That's our job. And if you believe that you can do, I mean, if you believe you can do it, it will come. And if what you're playing is, God, I really want to cry here, that's what they see. They don't see pain. They don't know what they see, but they see that it's not what the character feels, it's what the actor feels. And nobody cares what the actor feels. Doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. And how many has everybody's had this experience where you just thought it was awful? nothing going on. And everybody came back and said, God, that was fabulous. Or you're so tired that you can barely drag yourself up out of your chair. And everybody says, exactly, that's it, exactly that. Because you only have the energy to do the job. That's very mysterious.
Well, I want to get into film work because every stage actor that I've had here, we talk about their first times on film or television, how scary it was, because it's a whole different process. Yeah. Do you like the process of making television and film, and was it easy for you early on?
No, but it's fun. I love it. It's fun. Yeah. The thing about it is, in the movies and the television, even if you only have two lines, everybody's focused on you for those two lines, so it's a great narcissistic high, because hello. You know, some people have a narcissistic high that goes on for 6 months, and some of us 15 minutes. But it's okay. It's good. It's good while it's happening. And it's interesting work. Technically, it's interesting work. Both because what we provide as actors, even if you're the lead person in the thing, is basically furniture. And somebody else makes the room out of the furniture. Because in the theater, the actors determine what the audience sees, determine the focus. In the movies and television, somebody else. The director decides what the audience is going to look at. So as you know, you can be acting your socks off over here and it doesn't matter, except as a matter of courtesy to your fellow actor. But nobody's going to see that. So it doesn't exist. What exists is what gets recorded on whatever medium it is. And then it's put together by somebody else. And you have no control over it. And then months later, it's so different. Months later, this thing appears. I have to wait years because I can't believe that I look like that. So I don't see it right away, but you know, this thing that you feel oddly detached from appears, so that your experience of the, in a way, of the performance of it is quite different. But it's really interesting work, movies and television. And television, series television, if you have a big part, is a lot like factory work. It's really hard. And those people that are, you know, the leads on those things, the best job is to recur in about half a season in Los Angeles, because then they have to fly you in the front of the plane to Los Angeles. Everyone said, that's the best job. But the other job, where you're in it all day, every day, 18 hours a day, 6 days a week, that's killing. That's hard work. And those people earn their money, but the first time I ever did a television show, which is true for everybody, I was a lawyer, and I was the guest person, so they do your side first. I was terrified, and I was while we were doing Angels in America in Los Angeles. And so they shot it on a Friday, and I spent the entire weekend figuring out how they could fire me and hire somebody else and shoot around me the horror thing that I'd done. But they let me come back and finish the other side. It was terrifying, because it's like movies on speed. I'd made a couple of movies, and there's more time, and it's not quite so scary. But series television was really scary, because it was also on film. I can't imagine what it was like when it was live. To kill yourself. I have to kill myself. But and movies are great, because there's the luxury of time in great big movies, and then not in little tiny movies, which is even more like movies on speed, because it's a whole movie.
Well, my next question deals with, how do you work on a character? Do you work inside out, outside in? Do you have more time on stage than you do, like, you're doing a TV role or something, you have to do it really fast. How do you put a character together and how do you work?
I pretend. I realize I just make believe. You know, and as you do it a lot, you have more tools to make believe with. But that's what I really do. And I also find that there's a limit to how much research to do, say, for historical characters or historical periods, because then you begin to start doing the play that you would have written if you'd had all the time to do all this research. So that I also try to find the character on the page as much as possible. And then you need to do research about, if it's a period thing, research about the period and all of that. But it's make-believe. And I never found for myself that there are a whole lot of Meisner techniques and things, you know, substitution and all like that. I just find them confusing. But for some people, they work. They're wonderful. But I find them confused. For me, they put another... I begin to think about the person I'm substituting, and it's gone. It's lost. And every once in a while, some character appears, and you have no idea where it comes from. And it's from somewhere inside there. That happened to me with the rabbi in Angels in America, because I didn't know. I was in the very first reading of Millennium Approaches that I did. I didn't know what characters I was playing, and I was late to the reading because I was in a play. And I got there, and Tony Kushner handed me these things, and he said, okay, so you're playing the rabbi and the doctor and the Mormon mother and Ethel Rosenberg. And I said, okay. And I opened the play to find that the rabbi opened the play. And I opened my mouth, and out came the Rebbe Isidore Chemelwitz from the Bronx Home for Aged Hebrews. I don't know where came from the Anglo-Irish, whatever, American mongrel Protestant person that was sitting there. I didn't know where he came from, but there he was. And then a few years later, I found out where he came from. You never know. My husband and I were in the kitchen listening to some old radio programs, and they had the Jack Benny program on, and it was Mr. Kitzel.
Yeah.
And I'd been, 5 and 6, 7 maybe, when I used to listen to it, and those things lodge in your lizard brain, and you open yourself, and they come out sometimes. And then sometimes not, you know? Sometimes nothing comes out, and then you shouldn't be doing it. If you don't have anything for it, if you have the luxury of walking, you should walk away, because it'll be better for you and for everybody else. Weird.
Yeah. Well, you just started on my next question, which was Angels in America, which is one of your greatest achievements on stage. Was when you made your sort of official Broadway debut, right?
Was my... understudied in... Oh, well, there was Dance With Me.
Wait, let's talk about...
Broadway?
Yeah, that's sort of her unofficial. Dance With Me, was it the Mayfair?
Yeah.
In the Paramount Hotel, right? Downstairs.
Yeah, right.
The
Diamond Horseshoe, yeah.
So that was her unofficial Broadway debut. So
I replaced... Peter Riegert and I went into the show together for the last 6 months of it.
So this was sort of your official Broadway debut was in Tony Kushner's masterpiece, Angels in America. Go right ahead.
For Tony.
Receiving a Tony nomination for Millennium Approaches as Ethel Rosenberg, Hannah Pitt, the Rabbi, and other roles, how did Angels come about for you?
Those dreams you have, you know, you're walking down the street one spring evening and your acquaintance, Tony Kushner, walks up to you and says, you know, I've written a part in this play for you. Okay. And he walks away. And 6 months later, he says, you know that part that I said I wrote in the play for you? Well, we're doing a reading of the play. Would you like to come? That's how it happened. And it was in 1980. 88. The play started in 1987 in California, and the reason that there were women playing men in the play was that the play was commissioned for a theater company, the one that was run by Oscar Eustace and Tony Taccone then in San Francisco, that had a lot more women than men in it. And as those of you who know Angels in America, it's all men, hardly any women. So anyway, so that's why. And they had one older company member. And so I got her part. And I didn't know, you know, anything more about it. So after that first reading, we had more readings, and I said to Tony, "Oh, Tony, do I get to do the rabbi and the everybody again?" And he said, "That's the part."
How many years were you connected with the show?
From 19, I did the first reading in the first reading in the fall of 1988, under the auspices of the New York Theater Workshop, and I left it. Ellen McLaughlin and I left it on Broadway in 1994, so it was 6 years. And we went, Ellen, Steven Spinella, and I ended up coming with the dinner. There was a lot of blood on the sand, but somehow they overlooked us, and we got to hang on. So we got to do it Steven, obviously. Tony wrote the part for Steven, and he was there, but Ellen and I don't know, they kept us on. And we were happy. The blonde girls, you know.
So at which point did like Ron Liebman and Joe Mantello come in?
In the spring of 1989, we did all the developmental work for the play at the Mark Taper Forum in Los Angeles, because Oscar Eustace had moved from San Francisco to Los Angeles. So it was kind of our regular job. Every few months we'd go to Los Angeles and work on it and then go off and do whatever else we did. And Joe was the next solid company member, and Joe came pretty soon. He was in that first reading at the New York Theater Workshop, and oddly Stephen wasn't. Danny Jenkins read it, who eventually took over on Broadway. And then Stephen came, and then Ron was the next. And then we did a production that only Stephen, Ellen, and I from the core group did in San Francisco, because all the other people didn't want to be in it or something, which was a beautiful kind of poor theater version of it, directed by David S. Bjornson. And no one from New York would come to see any of it. And then Frank Rich, Tony was doing a production of Millennium Approaches at the National Theater. So then Frank Rich went to London and said, "Oh, this is a good play." So after that, he came to Los Angeles and said, "Oh, it's a good play. It's okay with Americans in it." So, and that's how we got to New York.
You knew right on how special this was,
everybody,
right?
Everybody knew. You couldn't hear, you know, it's like Mozart. The thing about Tony's writing is it's so beautiful as a thing. It's like Mozart. And sometimes that's a dangerous thing, because sometimes it doesn't matter what it says. You just want to listen to it. It doesn't matter. Who cares? Just talk to me, you know. And that's, Tony has the gift of beauty. The gift of beauty that sometimes he wishes he didn't have, but he has it. There's a wonderful painter, I'm sure you all know, named Anselm Kiefer, who has the same problem. He's a fierce, fierce painter, and they're so astoundingly beautiful that I think sometimes he wishes they weren't beautiful. I think he wishes they were more brutal. I don't know that that's true of Tony, but and Mahler, Mahler, and you know, Mahler too had the gift of beauty, and Tony's writing has that, so it was great.
The play was always changing, wasn't it?
Yes, though not as much as people. That Millennium Approaches was pretty well. Tony knew the structure of it and where it was going to go, and 80% of it or so was pretty solid by 1989. There were changes about what happened to Harper, the relationship between Joe and all that. But it was pretty solid. Perestroika, he knew the outline of, but had a much more complicated structure to begin with. And of course, it was going on while the It started in 1988, and it went through the collapse of the Soviet Union and all of that while it was all being written. So, in a way, it ended up being prescient. My personal favorite speech from it is Alexei Antediluvianovich Prilapsarianov's, the world's oldest living Bolshevik speech at the beginning of Perestroika, which was one of those great things I loved. It was great to do, and it's a wonderful speech. Perestroika changed a lot and continued to change all through the time even when we went to Broadway, and we had different directors, so people had different, ideas about it, what to do.
But what was it like doing one, rehearsing the other one when it was changing?
Was, you know how it is when you have too much work? It was great. We got Millennium up and played it, and as soon as it was started to play, we started rehearsing Perestroika, and we just never went home. We just lived at the Walter Kerr Theater.
As you look back on realizing you were in probably one of the most important plays of all time, you must have so many fond memories of this show. What does it all mean to you being a part of this whole experience?
I feel so incredibly lucky, really, to have been in the midst of it. It was so important in so many ways, not only the thing itself, the great beauty of it, it was the beginning. It was an important cultural icon for the beginning of gay liberation. It got to be the thing that people would bring their parents to the marathon days, and they'd come out at dinner in between and then come back or not, depending on how it went. And I met every gay Mormon in America, all of whom said, "You're exactly like my mother." And I thought, and Ellen talks about a wonderful phenomenon that started right away, even when we were doing it in Los Angeles, that you would see, makes me cry, you would see often sitting in the front couple of rows, because, you know, they're the TDF rows and all like that, a woman alone of a certain age weeping after it was over. And you realized that she was probably the aunt in the family, the only person that the kid could talk to. And it was so moving, all of that. So important. So it made you feel. And then you began to think that art really can change people, because it changes your lizard brain back here. So if people sat there for 7 hours, or however long it was six and three and three, 6 hours, for at least 6 hours, many people thought something they had never thought before in their lives, and especially when we got to Broadway, because, you know, we were, you know, Broadway's like a theme park, so if it's on Broadway, people go to it. It's not because they have anything, any other particular reason, actually. You're supposed to see this? Okay, we'll go. Come on, Maude, we'll go see that. And you could see that happened. And there were strange dramas every once in a while. I remember my favorite drama was that everybody stood up. We think everybody stood up because Joe Mantello has a great curtain call technique, which everybody should know, which is you go like this.
And everybody gets up.
Everybody stands up and starts to cheer. So anyway, Everybody always stood up. But one time, we looked out in the expensive seats, in like the fifth row, in the middle of the center section, a woman was standing up, and her husband, who looked like a person who would do this, you would imagine he looked, was trying to drag her out from between the seats. And in that weird way that people do, they'd waited till the end. You know, he had waited till the end to do this. And she fought. So there was this battle going on in the fifth row center. Whoa, that's pretty cool. There were great, you know, great. It was a privilege.
Yeah.
Lucky me.
But you've had another play like that, because I remember sitting through, I went to one of the double Millennium and Perestroika, and it was so moving just to sit there as an audience member and to sit there with everybody in that theater who was going through something or having a revelation about a family member or, like you say, the aunt or someone in that house. Another apple fell for you right after that, because one of the other greatest stage performances ever on stage was you as Vivian Baring in Margaret Etson's Pulitzer Prize winning play, Wit. And you won every conceivable, I mean, I named them early on, every conceivable theater award. Where do you keep your awards? Do you have like a mantle or a room? Do you have a room?
They're in the closet.
See? You got to take them out.
It's embarrassing.
Oh, listen.
Anyway, it's nice. It's very gratifying. It's stupid to say it's embarrassing, but it's very nice. It's gratifying.
Sure.
But I have to say that Wit is an example of the power of the director. Because Wit is a very, very good play. Very well written. Derek Anson Jones turned it into something else.
Yeah.
That production of that play transcended the work of all of us, and it was under Derek's leadership that happened. And the image that everybody remembers at the end of the play, some people are, I'll tell you afterward. Anyway, this wonderful transcendent image of Vivian standing at the end was something that Derek had to fight for. It's challenging, so not probably for Judith. I think everybody thought Judith looked swell naked, but I had often the following experience. I'd go out after, and everybody's really nice and everything, and then some man my sort of age, or maybe a little older, would come up to me and say, "You are so brave." I thought I looked okay. And it was always a man. Thank God I'm married. If I were looking, I'd be in terrible trouble.
Did you and Derek talk about that scene beforehand?
No, my big conversation about that scene was with my glorious, glamorous gay brother who was dying of cancer at the time. And he read the play, and he said, I gave him the play to read to see if it was true to his experience. And he said yes. And then the other thing he said was, if anyone ever asked you to do this play, you should do this play. So then it happened that I was asked to do the play. And then he said to me, "What about the nudity?" And I said, "Nudity?" Because it was in the stage directions. Who read the stage directions? "Nudity," said I. So there was there wasn't ever any talk about if or not. There was talk about when the first time I would actually take off all my clothes and stand on the stage naked would be. And it was at the first public performance, which was in New Haven. And directly in front of me were sitting one of our oldest friends' daughter and three male friends of hers who were all students at Yale who had come to cheer me on in the play. They knew more about me than ever. And then we were in a little tiny theater at MCC when we came to New York, and we lived then at 175 Riverside Drive in these big buildings. You know how you meet people in the elevator. You don't really know them, but you see people in the elevator. It was a little tiny theater. And I would see people, because when Vivian comes on, I'd see people from the building sitting right in front of where I was going. Pretty soon. And then there was the thing we didn't talk so much about being naked, because we had to do that, but it was a big deal shaving my head. And I ended up, because of the way the play went, doing it five times. Enough hair grew back in, because, you know, we'd stop or go, whatever. Four times, yeah. I guess, in cold blood. The first time, it was just going to New Haven, and it wasn't going to be for long, and I thought that was fine. And I did it, and my husband came along, and we did it, and that was all right, and I knew my hair would grow back. But after that, we spent a lot of time trying to see if you could do a bald cap, but you couldn't, and certainly not in a little tiny theater. But you couldn't anyway, because then it looked like not only did she have cancer, but she was a burn victim. And it would have, you know, and everybody thinks about wit as being a one-person show, but it's not. There are nine actors in the play. And, you know, off-Broadway, there's not so many thousands of people to look after the makeup and the hair and all like that, you know, the one person. So it would have been 5 hours on me and 2 minutes on everybody else, and it seemed just not, so we gave it up, and then I just shaved Henry shaved my head for me, because I thought he knew more about shaving than anybody. And it was weird. And it's all, you know, because a lot of people saw the play, but if people didn't know about the play or anything, they assumed that I had cancer, because I was wearing a hat and I was bald. Sometimes it was good. Sometimes you got upgraded on the airplane. And that began to happen a lot, and it took me a while to figure out what that was about, and then I felt terrible. I didn't move back to steerage, but I thought of it.
You know, you talked about the other cast members. Barnard Hughes' wife, Helen Stenborg, actress, and Doug Hughes, the famous director, his mother, was in the show, and upstairs you told me what you called her. Explain.
We called Helen the cleanup hitter, because she had those two scenes were the pivotal scenes in the play. Yeah. And everybody always talked about how they were crying. But I was dead. Helen was making them cry. So Helen, it was one of the great joys of my life. Yeah. And Doug was the guardian angel of the play and my guardian angel, because the truth is that if it hadn't been for Doug Hughes, I would never have done the play in New York. Because it did very well in New Haven, and there were commercial producers who wanted to move it, and they wanted a famous person. Why wouldn't you? And it was Doug, who, because the Long Wharf, there were three producers, and the Long Wharf was one of them, and the Long Wharf had rights to the play. And so Doug did two things. One of them was to honor a commitment that he'd made to the MCC Theater, which was to say that the play would have its New York premiere at the MCC Theater. And the other one, which Helen only told me years after the fact, that Doug said he wouldn't allow the play to be done without me. And I mean, you know, you think of the luck of that. The things that you owe to the kindness and honor of the kind and honorable people in the world, you know, and everybody bitches and moans about what a terrible life it is and all, like, it's not. It's filled with random acts of kindness. Not that, hardly a random act of kindness. It was a huge gift.
I didn't know that story. That's a beautiful story. You had tremendous loss during WIT also, because you lost your brother, and you lost your director, who was your dearest friend, too.
Yes. Derek, we didn't know. Derek didn't tell any. Derek Anson Jones was, I think, 43 when he died. He was a brilliant, gay, African-American director, and he thought that that was enough. So he didn't need the entire world to know that he was also HIV positive. So he didn't tell anybody. I'm deeply felt. I mean, anybody except his partner. But he didn't think he was a part of anybody's business. And he was an early success of the cocktail. So he was doing fine. But just as we moved to, just as we were starting to win stuff, Derek began to get ill. He'd have the flu or something like that, and he was one of the people that the cocktail stopped working for. And the day we opened in Los Angeles, January 17th, which was also his partner's birthday, he died. And it was so odd, we were on the beach in Santa Monica waiting to go to work, all the women in the company, talking to the hospital room, because they were all there, you know, with him that day. And he died that day. He was wonderful. And then, and there's a funny story about it, because nobody, when we did the play, nobody ever felt it necessary to mention that the director was African-American. And also, Derek looked like he was 25. So, and he wasn't so tall. So people come backstage, we're all wonderful, wonderful, and where's the director? And you'd point to Derek, and people would start talking to the tall white person behind him. And you'd say, no, this is the director. And then they'd have to rejigger their brain and all that. So we had, you know, the African-American director of this play on the one hand, and the high-profile lesbian second grade teacher as the playwright. So we were leaping all kinds of, and nobody cared. Nobody cared. It was wonderful. Wonderful. Derek's a great loss, a great loss.
And you lost your brother during it too.
And my brother died between the Long Wharf production and when we it was a year until we came back. Mm-hmm. So he died in April of 1998. But he got to see it.
Yeah.
He got to see it in at the Long Wharf. It was one of the last things he saw.
But they became a part of your performance in a way, didn't they? As the
they
show went
did.
On.
And my brother did very much because, in a way, he lived with us at the end in our house with my husband and our cousins. And we were his primary caregivers. And I learned to look after him from the play because, you know, we did lots of research and talk to people, and there's lots in the play. You know, I learned about the disease from the play, and I was with him when he died. I just moved into his hospital room and just stayed there the last few days, and I was there, and I learned how to play the part from him. I learned something about the end of the play. I learned how to play the end of the play from him, which was his last gift to me in a lifetime of gifts. His first gift to me was Joyce Grenfell Requests the Pleasure and the original cast album of My Fair Lady, which even though I can't sing, I know all the words to. If you're not careful, I'll sing to you.
Thank you for sharing those stories, Kathleen. Let's get into some of your other roles. Oh. Let's talk about Fanny Church.
Oh, Fanny Church.
In Painting Churches, Tina Howes.
Oh.
How much fun was she? I mean, the hats and the clothes you got to wear.
She was the best, but the most fun was being on stage for hours on end with John Cunningham. God, that was great.
Yeah.
It was wonderful, and Tina Tina Howe is one of those magical people who looks like, I don't know, she's 6 feet tall and beautiful and wears these wonderful clothes by this very spiffy designer. Anyway, she's great. It was, the whole experience was splendid. And John and I have known each other for a long time, and we had our, John works a lot with Franny Sternhagen, and Franny's a friend of mine, so we know each other in that way. And so, but it was a blast.
And then Nine Armenians, you received the Drama Desk nomination.
Yeah.
What are your memories of doing that?
Well, Nine Armenians was the beginning of my relationship with the Armenian community, which since being, it's Leslie Avacian's play, it's a wonderful play about her. Oh, well, I have another great story about Nine Armenians too. But so from the time that I did Nine Armenians until now, I have never done anything that did not involve at least one Armenian. One way or another, one of this television show that I did for 3 years called The Guardian, one of the lead producers was an Armenian person. That was a, I once lost my wallet in a taxi cab, and it was an Armenian person who found it and called me up and then wondered why I had all those credit cards, explaining to me that that was not a good way to live. I mean, it's gone like that. And then last season, I did a wonderful play. I got to play an Armenian again, called Red Dog Howls by Alex de Nilaris. And, you know, again, it's very mysterious. Am I the person you would choose? Somehow, middle-aged, well, I'm not middle-aged anymore because I don't know many people who are 140 years old. But anyway, you know, sort of middle-aged white women are the invisible people in the, you were invisible. So when you do non-traditional casting and things, it's likely to be middle-aged white women who are asked to do everything because we're invisible, sometimes for good and sometimes for ill. But anyway.
I like that. You won your second Obie for playing Susan in Alan Bennett's Talking Heads. How much fun was that, doing that show?
That was so much fun. Bed Among the Lentils, isn't that everybody's dream? Yes. It was great. I was in Los Angeles doing The Guardian, beyond being on the TV, having the good job where I got to fly in the front of the plane every other week or so, stay in a nice hotel in Santa Monica. Ah. Oh. Those were the days. They don't do that anymore. They hire you as a local. But anyway, before the days of local hires, Tom Hulse came to say, he tricked us into it. He came to say, would you like to come and read some of Alan Bennett in my living room? And we said, sure. And then the next thing we knew, we were doing it at the, for you people, any of you who spent time in Los Angeles, there used to be this wonderful theater up on Sunset Boulevard called the Tiffany Theater. And so we did it at the Tiffany Theater, and it was Swoosie Kurtz and Annette Bening and Brenda Wheel and Danny Davis, and I was in it. And it was great. And then he said, and then he tricked us into doing it in New York again. And Lynn Redgrave, Lynn was in it. It was a continuous joy. And Alan Bennett, who is a very, very shy person who suffers from agoraphobia, kept promising that he would come, but he never did. He never came.
Because you played the alcoholic wife of a vicar, right? Who's having an affair?
Yes.
Is it nice being up there by yourself?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
I mean, sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
It's nice in a thing like that because there are other people around. If you do a one-person show, it's actually lonely. Because, you know, the rest of it is you're all there but always by yourself. But Talking Heads was great because there were always these amazing people because all other people who were in it.
Sure. I read that a role which was the most fun for you to do is Calamity Jane. And she was in your friend, is it Sybil Pearson's
play? My friend Sybil Pearson.
Called True History and Real Adventures.
Yeah.
Talk about this, because it was like towards the end of her life of Calamity Jane, right?
Right. Well, it's a theme, I guess, because she was drunk too. And I'm quite drunk in Tales from Red Vienna. Sybil is my best friend. We're best friends not because of the theater, but because our sons, who are now 45, met when they were 5 years old and 4 years old at nursery school. And we began to hang out as mothers standing, meeting our friends, and then we got to be friends. And Sybil, who had been an actress, quite a well-known actress and had left the theater, started writing during the time that I knew her. And I was the first person that she told that she'd been in the theater before. So we got to be friends. And she wrote this wonderful fantasy based on a real thing about the Wild West. And I played a bunch of parts, including Calamity Jane at the very end of her life. At a bar. It was great. It was wonderful. And I also, Sybil believes that I can sing and dance. There are a few people who believe that. I disprove it at every, and so I also played a wonderful character called the Count, who sang and danced. And Rob, was it Rob Ashford? Was it Rob? Rob was the choreographer, I think. And he, it was all right. If you can count to four, you can dance, sort of. So it's all right.
You were great in that. I love it. Living the last years of her lives at Deadwood with the gun and everything else you did in that. I know a very important role that you did was in Guantanamo, Honor Bound to Defend Freedom. You played an attorney, and you also got to perform with Desmond Tutu, right, the Archbishop? And that was a very important night for you, wasn't it?
It was astounding. I begged to be allowed to do this play. I could only do it for 6 weeks because I had to do some other thing, and I crawled on my knees to the director and asked if I could do those 6 weeks, and they let me do it. And it was called Guantanamo, Honor Bound to Defend Freedom, and it was about the English British detainees at Guantanamo, and sounds like well. Corin Redgrave was a close friend of ours and of the family, and Corin had a great deal to do with working to get these detainees freed, and was very much involved with this event. And at the time, I was very much involved in anti-war politics and all like that. So I did the play, and it was interesting because when it was done in England, everyone was horrified, but there was some hope because the detainees got out. When it was done here, it was devastating because we were the people doing it. And the audiences would just be poleaxed because it was a time people didn't know so much about what, you know, went on in Iraq and all like that. And people would just be poleaxed, and they stopped coming because it was too hard. But at the very last performance, there was a speech that they gave, famous people do, when they were around, and the last famous person was Desmond Bishop Tutu, and he came and did the speech, and I got to reprise my part. It was a great luxury, and he was astounding, and he hadn't seen the play before. He just did it, you know, because he thought it was a good thing. And he spoke to the audience afterward, and he said, "Please don't let this happen. It happened in my country. Don't let it happen to you." Yeah. And it was just another privilege, you know, another time when you're sitting and the apple drops into your hand under the tree.
You know, you did Double Duty a few years ago off-Broadway. She did Dead Man's Cell Phone At Playwrights Horizon, playing the mother from Tuesday through Sunday, and then on Monday night, she did Vita and Virginia with Patricia Elliott on her only night off. So you worked every night of the week.
And we were shooting Duplicity at the same time.
Three jobs.
At three jobs. Well, sometimes you have no jobs. You have to take. You have to take the jobs you can get.
What was that like at that time period for you?
It was crazy, and. Yeah. The director of Duplicity, who's a wonderful man, kept saying, "Can you shoot today? Or are you in some stupid play?"
But somehow you got it all done, right?
It all got done, and I was awake most of the time. We had one all-night shoot, and I really, truly was. And it was the big scene, it was the big reveal scene in the play. And I was truly an example of how it's okay if you're unconscious, because some part of your brain will function.
Moves forward, that show you're doing, or that speech you have to do.
Somehow, I guess it was okay.
But you loved doing it, though. I mean, those are three great things to have worked on all
the
same
time. They were great things. And Patricia, it was great to do with Patricia Elliott, because Patricia had stopped acting, and she decided she wanted to do this, so it was her gig. And so we did Vita in Virginia. We did a lot. We did it on Sundays for a long, long time. Yeah. And then we'd do it around a little bit as a little party piece. So it was great.
Good for you. I want to get into some of your TV stuff. The Netflix TV series House of Cards. How many House of Cards fans do we have? Has become an instant hit. Talk about working on that show. And you played Margaret Tilden?
I did. I played Margaret Tilden. But then they went away from print. Yeah. So I don't think Margaret's coming back. I don't know. They didn't say. But anyway, it was a great
playing her. Talk about that.
Oh, God, it was so much fun. That another, somebody said, "Where? You want to come and do this?" So you get to sit in the back of the car and say terrible things. Again, say things. It was wonderful. And it's a wonderful job. It's very nice now that there's so much television production on the East Coast, because you can stay here, make a living, work in the theater, if that's what you mostly do, and support your habit on really, really, really good television. It's a great job. The House of Cards is terrific. It's a wonderful outfit. And they take very good care of you. Kevin Spacey is a terrific kind of leading actor. He's very enormously polite and makes a point of talking to everybody and welcoming you to the event and all. It was great. I really loved it, and I'm sorry they moved away from print, because it would have been nice to do some more, but it was terrific.
Yeah. On the TV series Rescue Me, you played Stephen Pasquale's mom.
Ma Garrity, my favorite part.
Yeah, was it really?
Oh, I love Ma Garrity. Because I don't get to play those parts, but I got to play Ma Garrity. And that was one of those times, it's an interesting audition story. One of those times when I had an idea for it. A funny idea. I don't even remember what the idea was, but I knew when I went into the audition that either they were going to buy it or not. But I had a real idea, and I did whatever it was, the idea, which is now long gone. And I got the job. And it was a great job. That was a wonderful show to work on. And scary, because it's, it was lots. The movies and the television are very testosterone heavy. It's a guy thing, mostly. And Rescue Me was a serious guy thing. But interestingly enough, there were a lot of women on the crew. And there were almost all the directors I had I think I did nine or ten of them, were women. And Dennis Leary is the funniest, scariest man ever. And the best part, that I was mostly with Stephen and Dennis's friend who played Stephen's, ne'er-do-well brother, Ma Garrity's favorite son. So mostly it was the three of us. But then toward the end, when Stephen's character got sick, we were in the hospital, and all the guys came. So they were all there, all those guys. And what you understood very quickly was just shut up. And because they bantered in a way that you couldn't, it would have been stupid to even try to jump in. And they were wonderful, great fun. And Dennis Leary was a wonderful leading actor. You know, it was his deal. And he took care of everybody. He was incredibly generous in if he had scenes, you know, if you were in scenes with him, because he wanted the thing to be good. That was a great job. I loved that job.
And then you got to work with Simon Baker on the TV series The Guardian. What is it like working with Simon Baker?
What it's like working with Simon Baker is every single female person you know wants to know what it's like working with Simon Baker. And could you get this picture signed, maybe? No. Simon's a love. He's wonderful. And in the you see him, how he is now on The Mentalist. It's more like Simon. But on The Guardian, his character was rather dour. And Simon's not dour. He's a very, very funny guy. And he's a one, he's also, he can sing and dance, as it happens. And is, as you may have noticed, very beautiful. And great. And I always thought that they should remake the Jimmy Cagney story, and Simon should play Jimmy Cagney. He would be... he's Australian, so I don't know if he even knows who Jimmy Cagney is, but he would be great. And he's... The Guardian was a terrific show to work on, but I have a very interesting story about The Guardian. On The Guardian, this was 10 years ago, so I wasn't 69, I was 59, and Alan Rosenberg was on the show, and there was a little arc where Alan and I were going to have an affair on the show, my character and Alan's character. And then we got the rewrites, and the affair had been reduced to one rather chaste kiss in the office, and then a few searching glances, and so I went in to see the writer, the showrunner, whose show it was, who had written this arc for us. Alan was into it, I was into it, right? And to see what had happened, and I said, the girls upstairs went, ooh, didn't they? And he said, yeah.
Wow.
Grotesque. That a
their loss.
59-year-old woman should kiss Alan Rosenberg. And God forbid, maybe she'll have to take her clothes off. Then what will we see? Anyway, it was really funny. And it was so obvious. Yeah. So obvious. You knew the programming people at CBS would... not happening on our show.
Well, you should have told them, rewrite it. I'll have a scene with a love affair with Simon Baker
with
instead.
Then they really would have gone, ooh.
You got to do on HBO Muhammad Ali's Greatest Fight, which is a fabulous TV movie. You played the wife of Christopher Plummer?
Christopher Plummer!
What was it like working with Christopher Plummer? Another one.
It was. And he too! Christopher Plummer, this wonderful man who's an professional, as an actor. So he's incredibly generous. He's not, I'm Christopher Plummer. But, you know, how should we do this and everything. And in one scene, and Christopher Plummer is even older than I, by a fair amount. And in this one scene, I'd wander out of the house, and we were shooting it at night. And the director said to Christopher, oh, you don't have to, you know, you don't have to run after her, follow her down the thing. And he said, no, that's the right thing. So out he came. Right. I mean, he was wonderful. And also, I had it, my granddaughter is now 5. She was then 3. She was deeply confused by this because she didn't understand how her grandmother was married to the captain. I tried to explain it to her. She never fully processed that, but she was excited in an abstract kind of confused way that 3-year-olds are. But he was wonderful and wonderful in that part. That was it. That was good.
Yeah. But she probably thought you were Maria.
She knew I wasn't Maria. Right away, she got that.
But she knew you were married to the captain.
Yes, she knew I was married to the captain. I was trying to explain that.
You did a film called Duplicity, which you said you filmed at the same time of doing all that triple duty at the time with your friend Dennis O'Hare.
Yeah. We had a good time.
Yeah.
We did have a good time. Dennis and I have known each other for a very long time. We've worked together and have people in common and all like that. So we were in it. And the great thing was the twist in Duplicity, nobody knew the twist in Duplicity. They didn't give us the script. So when Dennis found out, he was really mad because he said, "I thought I was your boss." But we had a wonderful time doing. Other people in Duplicity got to go to Rome, and we got to go to Greenpoint, but it's okay.
Locals, they hired the locals somewhere else.
And then in that movie too, I'm almost blind in one eye. I do drive because I'm from California. And I've driven all my life, and most people don't know that I'd have no depth of perception. I hardly ever hit anything. But in this, and I don't like to tell people, but what I can't do with any degree of confidence is drive close to something on my left side. And that was I was driving the getaway car.
It's a great film.
And the cameraman was here, and I was supposed to be driving like that. I was terrified. I never did hit him. And they cut that scene.
They've got to add it onto the DVD.
And then the other scary scene was driving on the off-ramp at JFK. They had the camera in the back seat, so you know how you had to drive.
Show business.
But you do.
Yeah. I want to go on to the film that you showed the most skin in, which is one of my all-time favorite films, Kinsey.
Ah.
Now, you were billed as the lady with the shotgun orgasm.
Yes, I was. And I want you to know that not one, not two, but three people said independently to Bill Condon, "Oh, Kathy will do that." And truly, they nearly got a XXX rating because of because of this scene, and they had to cut out a few frames.
Was it fun to do?
Well, no, it was weird to do because, you know, everybody, first of all, Bill Condon is the most wonderful man in all the world. No one else could ever have made the movie Kinsey. Yeah. Because Bill would talk to you and you'd think, well, of course, what's weird about this? This is fine. I can do this. It'll be great. So we went out to where it was being shot in New Jersey. And I, among other things, in the script, Liam Neeson is looking at a movie. In the movie, Liam Neeson, whom I know, was in the room. And it was at the end of the day, and I was in some dumb play, right? So I had to leave. And the time, you know, the time gets eaten up the way it does in the movies, and everybody it was all gonna be all very careful and no closed set and yada, yada, and it got later and later and later. And so then finally we had to do it, and there would only be time for at least two or three takes. And so it went up into the place, and it was pretty closed, but you know, in the movie, it's never a closed set. There are the other actors, and the camera people, and the sound person, and the director, and of course, the naked person on top of you, who is the other actor in the scene with you. And naked you underneath the naked person on top of you, who very quickly discovers, because there isn't any time, that he is your clothes. So that if he got up between takes, then I would be naked. So we lay there. For however long it took, I don't know. About, you know, 25 minutes or however long it takes. Our faces this far apart talking to each other about our children. and our families, and what a lovely day it was.
How many takes did you have eventually?
I don't know. Three. Two or three. I guess I had to go. Sorry, I can't do this anymore. I have to go, Bianca.
I gotta go. Well, they obviously got the scene.
They did. I got to build. It won an award from Planned Parenthood.
Yeah.
And Bill couldn't go, so he said, would you go and collect the award from Planned Parenthood? And so I did. And then I tried to give it to Bill, and he said, no, you keep that.
You earned it.
I earned it.
One of your latest films, that's a great story, is Isn't It Delicious? With Keir Delay and Alice Ripley?
Yes.
Okay, you play Joan Weldon. Who
yes.
is she? And you had a lot of fun working on that film.
I have to tell you, it's a theme. She's a drunk. Yep. It's about a deeply dysfunctional Irish family sort of striving. They've striven, so they're sort of middle in Connecticut, and the children are there are three children, all named after the Kennedy children. Joan drinks and smokes and is dying. So she's told that she's dying of lung cancer, and she decides to do nothing about it, and all her, because what the hell? And so it's the story of her, this family finding itself in a way. It's written, wonderful, wonderful screenplay by a writer named Kathleen Kiley. I think it's a lot about her family. And the director is Michael Kelly, who's a wonderful director who's done up to this time mostly documentaries. So this was Michael's first feature. And it was great. We shot it in 30 days in Connecticut during Hurricane Irene, during which time we were out on the Long Island Sound. We were out there shooting, and the Coast Guard came and said, did you notice that there's no one else out here? But we're shooting a movie anyway. Come in. It was that was great fun, and that's the biggest part. I mean, I was in every scene of the movie, and it was an extraordinary experience. This late in the day, to do it, and it was. We shot it for I don't know what was it? Nothing, $200,000 or something. Yeah. And it's done okay. It's had a little go-around in festivals and stuff. It was at the Big Apple Film Festival in New York and at the Independent Features Festival here in New York, and it's been around. And Keir Delay is like heaven. And his wife, Maya Dillon, is in the movie too. And Alice, whom I've known, and I think this was Alice's first big movie role too, and the two young men in it it's a really good movie. It's very, very upsetting to lots of people because it defines black humor, and it helps if you're Irish. You kind of get it. People who aren't Irish are kind of shocked by it, or think that it's not funny. They don't get what's funny about someone smoking and drinking and dying of lung cancer. It's an Irish thing, you know.
Yeah. How do you view the business today? I mean, if somebody was launching and people working in this business today, do you think you'd have the same type of career if you were starting out today?
I don't know. I think everybody makes it up in their own. In some ways, those little tiny theaters off Broadway that existed, there's versions of them now, because the theater, which everybody always says is on the verge of death, doesn't. It won't, I think. But there is the equivalent of that in media now. And I think that lots and lots of people are going to find their way through the new media, which are, you know, now because everything's digital, basically fungible. So, you know, some machine or another collects information that can be turned into you, and that's the where it will go, and it can go anywhere. I think people are only just now beginning to understand how to use it. I think it helps if you're younger, because some of us who aren't younger are very happy to have a grip on email, you know? And that doesn't cut it if you're doing this. My husband's a documentary filmmaker, so I watched him look like he was getting Parkinson's disease while trying to figure out the editing program. Mac, you know, he didn't get Parkinson's disease, and he's now knows how to do all that stuff, but it was harder. So I think that the kinds of, you know, theater genesis, Harvey Fierstein sitting behind you kinds of experiences are available and available in different venues than they were. People are but people, I notice that young people are doing the same thing we did, which is, you know, the modern version of, hey kids, let's, you know, rent a barn and put on a show using digital media, and people can make their own movies. The reason we could make this movie, which doesn't look like it was made for $200,000, is because of the digital technology and because our cameraman was a famous German cinematographer who had made a documentary with our director and had access to the top of the line camera. So that camera, our camera, was as good as anybody's camera. And that's, you know, again, in the movies and the television, it's what the image looks like that matters. The theater is mysterious. It's the same as it always was. You know, it doesn't go away. It morphs. There's a whole new, when I first came to New York, there were a lot of collectives, the Worcester Group and a number of them. Then there was a period when those collectives were having trouble holding together and people didn't. And now there are a whole new group of collectives that do amazing work. Fiasco Theater is one, the Epic Theater Ensemble that has an amazing education program in the schools. But those are two examples of collectives, and there are lots and lots, and those people move in and out of their theater collective, and in many cases support their habit by the movies and television. There used to be a joke that went around that says Dick Wolf should have been given a Tony for supporting the American theater, you know? And he did for a while, single-handedly, you know, made it possible for all of us to have health insurance and eat and feed our children and get a God pension. Whoever believed you were going to get a pension? Jeez.
Yeah.
Unions. Let's hear it for the unions.
My final question for you is, what is the best bit of advice that you've been given that you still live by?
There's so many. I'll say an acting one, because we were talking about it before. I was standing by for Elizabeth Franz in Sister Mary, and I played it on Sundays and between famous people after Elizabeth left. And so I was, one Sunday, I was doing the play, and somebody I knew who was a painter and not in the theater at all, very intelligent person, who was the widower of my friend Tosh, who just died, watched the performance, and he said, you know, you're not acting out to the ends of your fingers. And he was right. When the character's inside you and around you, it goes from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet and out to the ends of your arms. And it inhabits you in some way. And it's such a gift that's given to us, to those of us who do this, to be inhabited by these people and to give them to other people, because that's our job, and it's an important and honorable job, one that I think is an essential job. I think that art is essential to the human spirit and not an amenity for the privileged, and we're lucky.
Well, on that note, I have done this for a long time, and I have sat with many, many people, and I want to thank you for one of the most beautiful afternoons, being so open and sharing about everything that you've done. Kathleen, thank you, my love.
Thank you.
Kathleen Chalfant.